No suffering has ever been so unfitting. No human has ever been so unjustly treated, yet no other human has ever been so worthy of praise. No one has ever lived a sinless life. No other human has ever lived to be worthy to be called God himself. No horror surpasses what happened on the hill outside of Jerusalem almost 2,000 years ago. And yet, we call it Good Friday. We call it Good Friday. When Jesus was crucified, all of his disciples, except for John, forsook him. In the Gospel of Luke, the women stood helplessly at the cross, wondering what would be next. Everyone feared worse for the body of Jesus. But then a surprising thing occurred. Two unlikely men appeared. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicholas. Now it's very important to understand who these men were. Joseph, he was a good and righteous man. He was a member of the Jewish parliament known as the Sanhedrin. He was wealthy and he was expecting for the kingdom of God. The other important man, Nicodemus, we all remember who he was. He was also a member of the Sanhedrin, but he also was a Pharisee, and that means he believed in the afterlife and he adhered greatly to the law. You see, Nicodemus was a teacher of Israel, but he also enjoyed Jesus' teaching, and he was the one who secretly went to Jesus by night, and Jesus told him he must be born of the Spirit. One other important thing about Nicodemus, he actually came to the defense of Jesus, advocating for him to have a trial before they sentenced him. But definitely, the Pharisees rebuked him for that. So Joseph and Nicodemus, they were both rich, prominent in the Jewish community, and members of the Sanhedrin. So they had everything to lose by acknowledging Jesus as Lord and Savior. And when I say everything, everything, they risked losing their position in society, their career, and their wealth. But these two men, these two prominent individuals, had faith in Jesus. But it was a secret faith. And because they didn't want to be seen as outcasts among the Jewish society, they hid their faith. But the interesting thing about them, they hid their faith, yet they were at the crucifixion of Jesus. They were there at the cross. And something happened. Something amazing happened. In the death of Christ, their reservations fell. When they saw the way Christ died, when they saw him on the cross, when they saw him in agony, they knew that it was their sin that put Christ on that cross. Therefore, at that point, at that moment, they no longer were secret disciples. They acknowledged their allegiance. So he sent a message to the seamen saying, alter your direction 10 degrees south. The seamen responded, alter your direction 10 degrees north. So by this time, the captain was angry, and he sent another message and said, alter your direction 10 degrees south. I am the captain. He immediately received a response that said, alter your direction 10 degrees north. I am the third seaman, John. So at this point, he was furious because his command was not obeyed. So he sent a third message, knowing that it would definitely invoke fear. He said, alter your course 10 degrees south. I am the battleship. He immediately again received a response that said, alter your direction. Alter 10 degrees north because I am the lighthouse. You see, in the midst of life, you all, we hear all sorts of voices in the night telling us what to do, where to go, who to hang out with in church, where to sit, what to eat, etc. But out of the darkness, one voice emerges, and that is the voice that is the light of the world. Because here's the point. The strength of true discipleship consists of finding out the way God is going and going that way too. Yeah. This is how you will reflect the light of Christ. Yeah. Figure out where God is going. Not my will, God, but your will be done. So rather than letting Jesus' body be thrown in the common grave, Nicodemus and Joseph petitioned Pilate to take the body of Jesus. Pilate agreed, so they took the body, they wrapped it in linen cloth, and they buried Jesus. And so their commitment to Christ was heightened by the sacrificial gifts they gave Christ. First, Joseph gave Christ his tomb. Not just any tomb. It was a tomb fit for divinity, royalty, a tomb for a king, and that's very important. He gave Jesus a tomb for a king, so Jesus was placed in the tomb of a rich man. Jesus was placed in the tomb of a rich man. Nobody had ever laid in the tomb. And the tomb was in a garden. That is an extravagant gift to honor Christ as the king. Next, Nicodemus. Nicodemus also gave him an extravagant gift. Well, Nicodemus bought 100 pounds of spices, myrrh and aloes. 100 pounds. Here's the significance of the 100 pounds. The 100 pounds were fit not for a normal person, but for a king. Yeah, it would have filled the entire tomb of Jesus. Because true discipleship sacrificially gives honor to God. Sacrificially. So here's the irony of all of this. Two things. Jesus may have died like a criminal, but your Lord and Savior was buried as a king. And Joseph was saying, I don't care what the world thinks. Yeah. Here today I'm declaring, here is my kingdom. Yeah. That is amazing. And take note of who Jesus used to bury his tomb. Think about it. What happened to his disciples? What happened to his boys? What happened to his family? Yeah. Where were they? Yeah. Jesus used two secret disciples to honor him in his burial. And so when Joseph and Nicodemus, when they stepped up to true discipleship, they not only claimed Jesus' body, but they took on everything associated with that. Yeah. And now here we are today, church. We also must claim his body. Yeah. We also must embrace all the association for his church. Mm-hmm. We too must embrace all the stigma. Yeah. We We too must embrace all the doubt.
Yes.
We too must embrace all the social rejection, because there's no cost too great for the God we serve. Yes. And you know what else? As we embrace all the associations, it requires us to step out of our comfort zone.
Yes.
It requires us to sacrifice our time, money, talent, and service to fund the kingdom of God as his church. Because being a true disciple requires that we, in essence, we have to lose our identity and take on the identity of Christ. And that is complete discipleship. That's when you will experience all the promises of Jesus. So the story of the burial of Jesus, it sends a message to all of us. Every one of us sitting in this room who are living with a secret.
Yeah.
Everybody.
Yeah.
The message is clear. God cares about you.
Yeah.
God loves you unconditionally.
Yeah.
The message is that even with your secrets, even with your guilt, your shame, your sin, God loves you.
Yeah.
And when we stop and look at Calvary, what Jesus did for us, undeserving humanity, what Jesus did, then suddenly it's not even important to hold on to guilt, shame, or sin anymore.
Amen.
We let it go because it has no value. And like Joseph and Nicodemus, we can give it over to Christ. Because he is the one, he knows your faults. He knows your secrets.
Yeah.
And instead